Okay. Hope this will be helpful. I'm trying to record. Therefore, once again, permit me to welcome you, all of you, and without wasting time, let us share the screen so that we can get to our slides. I think I'll share the entire screen. Let me see. Get the entire screen sharing. Okay, I would like you to confirm to me if you can see my screen. Are you able to see the screen?
Yes, Doc, I can see the screen from my end.
Okay, that's great. So let me, okay, here we are. I think I can run this one, the slideshow. What about the slides? I was just rushing to do it. This is setting and grading university examination questions. The presentation is by Dr. Abdallah Zirava. I would like to talk about myself a bit. I am. I started teaching way back in 2002 when I graduated from the School of Education in Makerere University in Kampala. And that is more than 15 years that I'm teaching in the classroom. I started as a secondary school educator, a trainer, a teacher, and now I am. I got into higher institutions of learning, and I have an outstanding track record in assuring student success. And I think I was also awarded in the ICT University as an outstanding faculty member of the year that has taught successfully and in an outstanding manner. And therefore, I have a record in assuring student success. And I have a very extensive background in developing and implementing multimedia for classrooms. I have taught several teachers, very many teachers, because before I even came to Cameroon 6 years back, I was already in the School of Education in Makerere University, helping teachers to integrate ICTs in their teaching and learning processes. I'm also a course designer. I'm a course designer and programmer. And I have a PhD in education. I want to admit people, I have a PhD in ICTs, applied ICTs in education. I don't know how I'm going to be doing this at the same time, because I'll need to admit people. Then I would like to say that the reason why we are here is because we want to ensure quality assurance in education. Quality is at the heart of teaching and learning. When we talk about teaching and learning, the first thing that should come to our minds, our focus, is to do quality education so that the students learn better. Once we have a very good education system that assures quality standards, we are likely to impact on our enrollments, we are likely to impact on our attendances, attendance of students to our classrooms, retention, and completion. And I think these are key aspects that we need in the ICT university. We need to ensure that we have a quality education system, which of course helps us to have many numbers because the students will trust us. They will know that we give a good product that can help them to be competitive in the job market. They will also know, and because we are giving them quality, they will come to classes and attend, and certainly we will retain them. They will not leave because they are happy, they are getting the best of what is supposed to be given to them, and this will help them to complete. Can you mute your microphone, please? We are getting disturbed. Whoever gets in, please. The rule is very clear. Have your microphone muted so that we don't get interruptions. Therefore, assessing and testing is not enough. Much as we are here to talk about assessments, grading, testing, That is not enough intervention in our teaching and learning process, because it may not necessarily grant quality education. There are other factors that we need to put in place. We need to look at. We need to do more as teachers. It is not that, you, for example, you don't teach in a very bad way without using the right proper teaching approaches, and then you expect to set a good examination question to ensure quality. If you have not done what you are required to do in the teaching process, because teaching is a process, it starts with planning before you go to the implementations and you get to the assessments and evaluations. So if you have not done well at the other processes, at the other aspects, you are likely going to, of course, have issues when it comes to quality of education. So we need to do more. And that's why I'm saying that you cannot fatten a chicken by weighing it. You cannot say that when you weigh chicken, you have it will fatten. No. If you measure, you assess, and then the teaching process has not been the best. And of course, that will certainly not ensure quality. Permit me to talk about assessment types. We have two types of assessment or evaluation. We have the formative assessment and the summative. Now, formative is what you do in your time.
Sorry, Dr. Abdallah.
Yes.
Please, good morning.
Good morning.
Sorry,
sir,
to interrupt your presentation.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Watiu.
Yes.
Happy with you. Please mute your mic. Please. We are getting a lot of noise from the background. Sorry, Doc. Please carry on.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you. That's as always. Wow. Wow. Okay. Let's just continue. We have actually what we call the formative assessment. And formative assessment is done in real time in our classrooms as we try to improve our teaching and learning. Formative is when we evaluate in our classes. Like, for example, you may just give a simple test at the end of your lesson. That is in order to try to understand whether the students have understood what you are teaching them, or to also understand whether your teaching objectives have been met. You do that in real time. You give real information to students, to feedback to students, so that we improve teaching and learning. And in the ICT University, we are always doing that. Now, the only mistake that we make is to think that we will give CS and tests at a certain given period of time of the semester, and we don't do formative evaluations per lessons. We are thinking that every lesson, every class you do, you must do a formative assessment to understand whether the students have understood what you are teaching them, and also to know whether you have achieved your learning, the lesson objectives. So the formative evaluations and assessments are supposed to be done almost every week. As long as you have done teaching at the end of that particular teaching or within the teaching, because even asking a question to a student in class, like said Dr. Abdallah, can you tell us what this means? You are actually doing formative evaluations and assessments. And then we also have summative assessments and evaluation. These are actually at the end of the semesters, end of the programs, and they are standardized information to make us make decisions in admissions, because we have diagnostic assessments or progression assessments or promotion or to graduate and all that. So these are exams that we give either at the end of the semester, or we give at the end of the program. Some of them are national exams, and students prepare for a long time before they get to this level. And when we assess them, we have intentions either to take decisions on whether we should admit them, or whether we should promote them, or whether we should graduate them as people, as students that have satisfied the requirements of the program or the semester or the particular course. So this is actually also done in the ICT university. We are always giving summative evaluations and assessments at the end of the semester, where instructors are required to set exams so that the students can write end of semester exams. Now, if we want to set semester exams very well, we must understand Broome's taxonomy. Benjamin Broome is a scientist that really worked on a certain level of understanding of setting questions and also teaching. Benjamin Broome takes us through the six levels or what we call educational objectives. We are teaching students to acquire knowledge. We are teaching students to comprehend. We are teaching students to apply. We are teaching students to analyze and synthesize and also evaluate. So for teachers to set such questions, set good questions, their question papers must reflect the different levels of Broome's taxonomy. We are from simple to complex, and we are here to discuss that. We would like to understand these levels and also how we can integrate our questions. I'm going to demonstrate to you the kind of questions that we can set that capture these very important levels of Broome taxonomy.
You are currently the only person in this conference.
Framework. So we are going to discuss this further, but those are the levels. And every time you sit down to write a question, if you are setting a question, you must understand exactly the level in which the question belongs. Are you putting up a question to ensure that students generate knowledge? They give you back what they have understood, what you want them to give? Or are you testing their comprehension and understanding? Are you testing how they can apply a certain aspect or certain level? What are you really doing? Do you want them to analyze certain aspects? You want them to evaluate? Do you want them to synthesize? All these questions and all these aspects must be in your question paper. But as we said, some of us don't even think about this. We just get questions from either question bank, and we put it on a Word document and do our submissions. When we look through it, we may see that some of the important levels of Benjamin Broome's taxonomy framework are not discussed and are not actually presented in this question paper. So the purpose of this workshop is to help teachers to understand the Broome's category or levels by utilizing the definitions, the key verbs, and the common question types for each category. That is the main purpose of this workshop. And I would like to get into level one, that is remembering. We have actually the keywords here that we use in our questions, and then the questions. When you see keywords like define, find, how, label, list, match, name, relate, select, show, spell, we are actually trying to satisfy level one of Broome's taxonomy framework, which is to help our students to remember what we've taught them or to give them the knowledge. So the questions can be, what is, where is, how did, why did, when did, how would you show, who were the main, which one, who is, when did, all that. So that whenever you see a question having such verbs such keywords, you just understand that we are trying to satisfy Bloom Taxonomy's level one, that is remembering all knowledge. So for level two, which is understanding or comprehension, we have these ones, compare and contrast, demonstrate, explain, illustrate, interpret, outline. So you can ask questions like, how would you classify? How would you compare? How would you contrast? State in your own words, rephrase the meaning of this. What facts or ideas show this and that and that? In that way, you are trying to actually to satisfy this level of Bloom's taxonomy framework, which is understanding or comprehension. Now, I would like us to do an activity. We have only 10 minutes to do this activity, I will allow you to reflect a bit in strictly 10 minutes. I want you to identify the Bloom's taxonomy keywords and questions in the six levels of Bloom's taxonomy framework. I have already done the two. So can you continue from there? And then when you get back to us, you can give us the keys and also give us the kind and examples of questions. I'll give you opportunity to, participants to tell us. I'll keep going. I'll keep going.
Yes, we're hearing you. We're hearing you. Yes, hello, Doc. Greetings. Yes. Yeah. So I just want to thank you very much. What a very compact review of the entire process you're talking about, and I think everything makes sense. But I would have loved, maybe if it's possible, I don't know if you actually prepared for that. Some of the things you've actually stated that will serve as a guide for most of us attending here. If we could have just maybe one or two sampled kind of questions and maybe a corresponding answer too, so that they will just it will be easy to just drive the message across. So when they are saying it, they picked it. And see, it has a very good sample, so it become a reference material for everybody. So when you are actually setting your own, you'll be adapting it to this standard you created. Thank you.
Yes, Doc, I can see your screen.
to another level, that is level 2. Level 2 is the step you are seeing, you are demonstrating and understanding. You are not just using memory or handy material. You are not just using, but we are level 2 from whom we are demonstrating, understanding, ideas, by analyzing, acquiring, forming, completing, and giving to. So we use these keywords. So these are some of the threads of the text. So we can use things like the apply, compare, and contrast any text. So that one is not a good one now to communication. So this one we can say in communication and knowledge production, we have a thin line. But I can say in your own words, okay? In your own words. Explain. No, compare. Compare is contrast. Contrast is different. Apply the contrast. Apply the contrast. Now, this one gets us now to another level of Rumi taxonomy, and of course, we want to see how many marks we can allocate. We are going to take this to this picture. You need also to be very careful in how you allocate marks. Because you are taking from simple to complex. So, if you take from too simple, according to Rumi taxonomy, don't allocate fast marks. So, this one is very subjective, and you must be very careful as you award marks. Maybe you can say, five, maybe 4 marks. Just give an example, 4 marks. Okay. And in your marking guide, 4 marks. And in your marking guide, you are going to allocate how you are going to allocate. Okay. Maybe you say 2 marks for
So please going to go to class, you want to go to class,
We can go to the last level. Our last level is the creating, this is our last level, legacy. We want now to take the next level in a certain way and build the new part of the old offensive. So we need to see what we are doing, change, profound, profile, construct, develop. That all of these are overlapping each other. So by now co-creating, we can only take one person there, co-creating, the last logo, creating, we can actually say design and implement and use the model to explain what is the same
and that's how you appreciate it. The next is there. Doctor, I'm sorry, you're not there. I just came in to discuss before you come in. Hello, Doctor Dala. Hello, Doctor Dala. Can somebody hear me, please?
Prof, I think he is waiting for you to finish.
Okay. Let me just conclude before he finishes. I'll just wait in because he was not there.
You are loud and clear. You are loud and clear. I can hear you very well. I can hear you very well.
Hear you, Doc.
We can hear you very well. Yes, I can hear you very well.
Hear you.
You have gone off again. Thank you.
I will recommend you to the video, please. The video will be one person.
Put up the video. Yes,
better
now. You're better now.
We can get better. Mm-hmm.
Yes, it is better now.
Yes.
I can hear you very well, Dr. Abdullah.
Thanks very much. At the time when you black out, I intervened. I must tell you that. Thanking you for taking this advanced step. But however, I was just reiterating some very key concerns, which of course I will bring to your attention that I regret the absence of the human faculty who are the policymakers in the faculty and not here. And of course, I weigh in again on the examination guidelines protocol, which we all have at the faculty level. What are the requirements for patients? And I clearly indicated that the questions requirement should not be less than 5 questions. It should cover at least 80% of the course material. And I put away that each objective should have questions, and I advise that it should be broken down into units A, B, C, just to give an update for our check. Then equally, I was going to say that there is a